always ask the wife, I said, well, just tell me, does he become sexually aroused when he's wearing women's clothing? And I said, if he does, then it's probably autogynephilia or transvestic fetish disorder. And so, you know, this is what's so funny to me. That's why I'm smiling. This is not complicated. You know, this is not, and I said, he's not transgender. He has a sexual fetish disorder, a sexual arousal disorder. Taking hormones and having surgery in many cases numbs down their ability to have a sexual arousal, and they become so dissatisfied with having gone through this, they regret it. There's a cause and effect that the hormones don't allow them to become aroused like they once did. So they go, wow, gee whiz, this is not working, right? It did for a while, but then over a period of time. So I've had people write me, a guy wrote me and said, I've been in therapy for over 20 some years with my gender dysphoria. And I wrote him back and I said, well, you don't have gender dysphoria. And I said, tell me more about your life. I said, and so we had this exchange of information and came to autogynephilia. And he writes, it was clearly he had autogynephilia. He became sexually aroused wearing women's clothing. I said, your therapist has been collecting whatever he's been getting out of you for years, but he would never address the real issue. And he says, this makes me so sick. I had to go through all of this stuff, two or three emails from you, and I realized I had autogynephilia, and a therapist with a PhD never told me that. Mm-hmm. I mean, I try to use terminology that wakes them up. This is not some benign little thing. I say, here's your wife over here wanting to love you. You have four children. You're ready to go in and have hormones and surgery, destroy everything because of a sexual arousal disorder. Is that really what you want to do? Is that really the value that you want to lead in your life?
I think it makes it easier for people to see that there is a disorder at work here. You know, Walt, this is the thing. In the Catholic Church, we refer to the homosexual desire as intrinsically disordered. Okay, people think, oh, that's so mean, that's so terrible. But if you understand that the sexual urge is supposed to be directed to something in particular, namely reproduction, you know, so being aroused by a person of the opposite sex is perfectly normal. And if you're aroused by something else, that's disordered in the sense that it's not ordered toward its proper end.
That's exactly right.
To help people see that, when there's so much confusion in the air, you know, it's like we're breathing toxic air, you know, that you can't see what's really true. Everybody's affirming you because you're so brave, because you're different. You know, being different is valued in and of itself, without realizing the psychic load that you're carrying. That's what strikes me. That's what I keep hearing from people. Does that term make sense? It's like you're trying to say this is perfectly normal, but somewhere inside you know it isn't perfectly normal, and you're trying to struggle with that. Comment on that. Am I off base here?
I think what I see is, and when you dive into these things, that these individuals, men who are struggling with this, somewhere early in their life, before they got married, that's the way they developed their sexual arousal. It was without a woman. And they had the opportunity to have a wife and have children. But there was this thing that got locked in early in life that they needed, just like grandma cross-dressing me not dealing with the initial issue. That individual, and I explained to them, you needed to address that sexual arousal before you got married, because this is what started early in life. It happens to teen kids, early adulthood. And this gets locked in as the way they get sexually aroused. That is sort of, it's hard to pull back on, and you have to begin to dismiss the things that you see with your eyes that gets you sexually aroused. And so you have to put those things aside. Now, it's not easy. It's one of the more difficult challenges that they'll go through. But once I always feel like if you understand what it's about, that it's not about you, it's about how you developed that arousal disorder, that you can also undevelop it.
And in the name of love, in the name of love for your wife and children, why not? You know, and yeah. do, so do you Do you find guys being able to step away from that? Back in the day when most of the guys you were dealing with were, most of the people you were dealing with were men and were out of gynophiles. In that period of time, did you hear back from people that they successfully
Yeah.
overcame this?
Well, there were, I think the ones that successfully overcame it were the ones where the wives hung in there with them to deal with it. Many of the wives would just couldn't do it anymore. And so that left them in this wasteland of not having that opportunity to have the wife to get him aroused. So they're out. Then they just sort of hung in and just stayed with it as a single man. They just did. They went back to what they learned in their teens and just stayed as an autogynephilia. So I think that once I have the opportunity to work with a wife who's hasn't completely been destroyed by this whole thing, get her to understand that she's
right.
She can be part of the process, just like an alcoholic. This is, I think we need to think of it almost as an addiction, and that
yes,
you can process it just like you can in the 12 steps of Alcoholics Anonymous. You're at first, you're powerless over these initial ideas because they were locked in. And I know in my own life, I used the 12 steps to help me recover from the whole idea of being a different person. So our identities need to be in Christ and not in some label that we slap on ourselves. And I think one of the things that we have today, Doctor, is that people, we're becoming more of a society of labels. And now we have everybody wanting to slap a label on themselves. I'm a detransitioner. I'm a this, I'm a that. And I go, really, you're much more than a label. I'm sorry. You're a much more beautiful person than a label. And I'm not a label person.
I want to go back to the wives, okay?
Yeah.
Because, of course, the Ruth Institute deals with all kinds of issues that have to do with marriage and family and human sexuality. And, I just want to say that we have heard from what they call themselves trans widows.
Yes.
And these women are in agony. I mean, what their husbands have put them through is really, really
horrible.
Awful. What you just said there, I want to just make sure we're really clear. If there are any women in this situation listening here, you can be of help to your spouse, but you are not required to put up with an endless amount of stuff from him. At some point, you have a right to say this is enough. Just like the wife of an alcoholic or the husband of an alcoholic wife, you have the right to say, hey, I love you. I'm not going to run off with somebody else. But the fact is, you need to, it's now on you. You need to deal with your addictive process. And until you do, get out. I know men, I know alcoholic men where that has been what changed their lives. It's like, oh my gosh, my wife is really going to finally kick me out.
There's really something important here, and you nailed it, and I want to emphasize it. And that's why I tell the wife when I have an opportunity to talk to him, he's having an affair outside the marriage. That is reason enough to let him go. Now, if you love him to the degree of where you're willing to hang in there and help him with that, that's your choice. But he's having an affair with clothing. I mean, the wives are always telling me, runs off to a hotel and dresses for the weekend and runs out. That's having an affair because he's becoming sexually aroused and you're not involved in that process. So yes, they don't have to put up with that. But if they have the mindset to do that, and maybe they have the strength and ability to walk through that. I would never discourage anybody from trying it. But it's a huge ask.
Yes, absolutely. It's a huge ask. But, I hear from people who have experienced childhood sexual abuse, and it's not unusual to hear that part of their recovery from that was a sympathetic spouse. Right.
Yeah.
And so, the power of a loving spouse is astonishing. It's miraculous. Okay.
Yes.
It's miraculous. Let's just be real clear.
Yeah.
Right. So I hope this part of the conversation is helpful to all of you, Ruthies, because I know we have people all over the map, with these type of issues. And you can see it's a complex There's a lot of moving parts and a lot of complexities to it. And this all started because I asked you, Walt, what were people, what have you observed? What changes have you observed? And we got the chance to talk about this aspect of the transgender thing, whatever you, however you want to describe it. What are the people like now?
Yeah.
The people that reach out to you now, they're probably somewhat different. In what ways are they different? Who's reaching out to you now?
Yeah, the ones that I get now are, they are part of the social contagion. They just do it because their friends are doing it, because they want to join a group. They want to be a part of the current trend. You know, if we go back and think through these things, there was goth some time back. Remember, everybody was wearing the chains on their boots. And so children in their teens have a tendency to join groups or to be, they try to be different. This is one of my favorite things. They all try to be different and they end up all looking the same. And so when I was in high school, it was a certain, you had to have these real thick soled shoes and you had a leather jacket, you know, Fonzie. I was the Fonzie group, you know. And so that was the way people were. And if you didn't do that, you were out. And so I've had teachers tell me at conferences, I have kids come up to me in school and tell me they're afraid to not identify as transgender.
Wow.
Because they will be bullied.
Wow.
So we have a whole group of people that are identifying as trans because it's popular and it's acceptable and it's the way that you people look upon you as being cool. And when I was growing up, it was, you know, I had to have a 34 Ford with a Corvette motor in it to be cool, right? I mean, I was already dealing with my other stuff, but cars were the big thing. So I think we need to understand that I work with from 10 to most of them, 10 to 25, really aren't, they don't have gender dysphoria. They get caught up in this because their friends are doing it, because it's kind of a social thing. I did have one that I wrote an article about. His name was Nathaniel, and his parents took him to get hormone blockers at 15. This is published in Daily Signal. And they took him to get hormone blockers at 15. They were supported him, encouraged him, affirmed him. He had the surgery. They went to had his genitals cut off, breast implants at 18. At 19, doctor, he writes me a letter and said, in his words, not mine, I feel like a Frankenstein monster. Can you help me get my life back?
Yeah. Yeah. But in that case, was the social contagion being driven by the child himself or by his parents?
In that particular case, when I dug into it, he was addicted to pornography at 15 years old and confused him about his identity.
Oh, wow.
So
wow.
He was actually isolated and not really a part of any group. That we find that the pornography tends to put you in, you know, you're just addicted to your computer. And that's your life. Your identity becomes kind of, and we have a lot of children who are addicted to their computer. And I tell parents, and I'll say it right now, if you have a child that's addicted to his computer, two things. One, take it out of their bedroom and don't let it let them have it in their bedroom. And two, check what their search engine is on a daily basis, what they're looking at, so you know what they're looking at on their computer.
And they should also get rid of the smartphone.
Absolutely. And you will be amazed at what they're looking at on both their smartphone and on their computer. Yeah. It will shock you.
Yeah. Yeah. So the young people that you're seeing today are quite a bit different from the mature men that you were seeing 15 years ago, 17 years ago, whatever it was. You have often said that there's almost always some kind of trauma in the background that have caused somebody to think they were born in the wrong body or what they hate their body or whatever. But these young people who are dealing with the with the social contagion aspect of it, do those kids have trauma in the background as well, or not
some
so
of,
much?
Some of them do, but not as much. When I do find out and dig into the history, I have things like, mom says, no, he didn't have any trauma in his life. And I said, well, tell me, what was his life like? And we're going back and forth with emails. Well, he did have cancer when he was 7 years old and they had to cut his leg off.
Oh, well, that would count as a trauma.
Yeah. But this is my point, that why I brought that up. Many parents don't even understand what trauma is.
Right, right.
And so they don't recognize this as trauma. Or I had a 12-year-old whose father was killed in a private plane crash. That wasn't thought about by the family as trauma. Mom was an alcoholic. All these things, if we're better as parents at understanding what trauma is, we as parents can identify something that happened. And so I have to do some pretty good probing with the parents. If the parent just doesn't understand, and once they do understand, they go, oh, well, gee whiz, I didn't even think about that. So this is, but it's gone on from the time they were 5 until they're now 17. And they're getting ready to have surgery at 18 because it's legal, then you've got a big challenge to unwind all of that stuff that was done. And so sometimes we're successful and sometimes we're not. I mean, if I can intervene enough, I had about 4 cases in a row where we were able to intervene and save all of them. They happened to all be girls. They happened to all be young, 15 to 12. They're working with the parent. And they all disclosed something to the parent that the parent did not know about. One of them was being sexually abused by a family member, and other things that happened. So I think there's some definite clues when a parent sees a child doing this that you go, the parent needs to go, what's going on here? Because this is not right. And so,
right.
You know, I one. One, I really love this one because the guy was 73 and he wrote me, I was watching Tucker Carlson. That's how long ago it was, whenever that was, at 8 o'clock at night. And I get a note on my computer and he says, I'm 73. I have a gender therapist who I really love and the sessions are wonderful. And I transitioned whenever it was and I had gender dysphoria. And I did look at your website. Now, see, when he writes me and he says he looked at my website, why would somebody who's happy with what's going on be looking at my website? Clue one, right?
Well, right.
So because I'm such a little sweetheart, I wrote him back and I says, well, your gender therapist is a quack. You don't have gender dysphoria. You never transition and you're not a transgender, but if you want to work with me for a little while, I bet we can figure out what really happened. And so I told my wife, I said, this guy's not going to write back. Well, he did. He said, well, that's kind of curious. What do you want to know? And I said, well, you said this, the onset was when you were 13. I said, all I want to know is what was happening in your life at the age of 13. And this is, I say this because every parent, every individual listening, should want to look and identify the onset, what was going on. And so I said, just detail to me what happened when you're 13. Oh, he writes and says, well, my mom was a raging alcoholic and she would get a butcher knife about 3 times a week and chase my dad around the house trying to murder him. So I wrote back and said, I'm not a therapist, I'm not a doctor, but I do think that might be trauma. And I said, And so I said, when you go back to your gender therapist, you tell your gender therapist that Walt Heyer said you need a trauma therapist. You're going to love the rest of this. This is a fantastic story. You need a trauma therapist, not a gender therapist. And don't wear your little red pumps. Don't put on a dress. Just go as a scruffy guy. Take your makeup off when you go in there. And be sure to tell him Walt Heyer Sex Change Regret sent you. And so he writes me a couple days later and he says, I went in there and told her I'd written to you, and you said I need a trauma therapist, and because of this trauma that happened to him when he was young. Now, she had been counseling him for 3 years, right? And he says, you know, I need a trauma therapist. And she said, oh, well, I'm also a trauma therapist. But she never asked the question.
Never entered her mind to ask this question.
Even if it did, she's collecting the bucks, right? She says, well, what I'm going to do is instead of the usual 1 hour session, these are my words, rip you off for $225, we'll actually do some therapy. And so I'll test you on the trauma scale for ACEs. And so he came out 7 out of 10 on the trauma scale. So she applied EMDR therapy. I'm not an EMDR advocate for that. She just said that was what she was going to do. He wrote me and said she did EMDR therapy. It was horrible. It was painful. I did not enjoy it one bit. But he says, Walt, I'm free.
Wow. One session?
One session, 60 years in one therapy session where they addressed the trauma that had caused him to dive into this alternate identity. And I checked in with him for 4 weeks after that. I said, are you sure you're still free for 4 weeks? Every week he said, yeah, I'm free. I asked him, I said, you know, I'd like to write an article and publish it about your story. He said, I'm so ashamed and so disappointed and so upset and so sick. I don't want my name or this article, any article to be written about it. This is ridiculous. Never should have happened.
But you're talking about it. Obviously, you're not revealing his identity or anything right. like that. Is he okay with you talking like this?
No. Well, yeah, he's okay with me talking about it, but he doesn't want me to put it in print.
I see. Okay.
Yeah. Didn't want me to do an article. So,
well, you know, this type of story is, you know, what does one make of one anecdote? You know, this people will always come back with that. But it's one data point with a lot of other supporting kind of data points. So make of this one story, people, Ruthie's, make of this one story what you will. But it's part of a larger picture that Walt is drawing for us, that trauma matters. Do you know our young friend Chloe Cole? Perhaps you know Chloe or ever encountered Chloe.
Yeah.
She shared with us, when I interviewed her, she shared with us that only after she had tried the transition and was kind of walking it back, did she realize that at some point, some kid in school, when she was like 13, had pushed her up against the locker and pressed his hands against her breasts. And it finally made a connection in her mind. Oh yeah, I don't really like these breasts. I was kind of glad to get rid of them, but she hadn't put that together in her mind until she'd gone down this path and then started walking it back. And she goes, oh, maybe that was relevant.
Yeah.
You know, maybe that was relevant. And she's a very dear soul in the sense that there's not an ounce of blame towards her parents or her family or anything like that. You know, and I always respect that when people are able to, you know, talk about their trauma, talk about their life without blasting other people, you know, with a lot of negativity.
And she suffered a trauma. She suffered a trauma with the divorce in her family. I mean, there was a broken family. And so, you know,
that's huge. Huge.
So it takes two or three events sort of to make the culmination, like with me, of grandma cross-dressing, the physical abuse and the sexual abuse. It's usually not just one occurrence.
Right, right. Now, Walt, I'd like to summarize the terminological issues, okay?
Yeah.
Because we've gone back and forth about this a little bit.
Yeah.
I wrote a pair of articles in the National Catholic Register, and in one of them, I laid out all the different things that the word trans is sometimes used to mean, or the different kind of person who puts that label on themselves and stuff. And the conclusion I was trying to drive at there is, you know, look, when one word means 9 different things, the confusion is the confusion is deliberate. The people who are doing that are they know what they're doing. They know
Absolutely.
They're creating. And they're up to no good. You know, they're up to no good when they're making it that hard for people to have clarity. What is your preferred terminology in all of this stuff? What are the words you like to use? What are the words you don't like to use?
Yeah, well, in my book that I wrote, I called them trans life survivors, not detransitioners. People have slapped detransitioner on me. On my website, I call it getting your life back. not detransitioning. Uh-huh. So you really had a life and now you're just getting it back. Because here's why I don't like, you know, when the doctors testified in court that you don't transition, then there are no transgenders. If you right. can identify as a transgender, but you can't become a transgender, then the term is kind of moot. It doesn't exist. And strangely, I've been on panels, world panels, where in other countries, they always say transgender identifying person. They never call anybody a transgender. Mm-hmm. And so if that's true, then nobody transitions. So that word isn't even correct, right? If you're not a transgender, you didn't transition. And then what I found is that gender dysphoria, as you know, probably better than I do, is that they put that in the DSM in 2013 to replace gender identity disorder, not because it was a better way to diagnose people. And what I believe today is that gender dysphoria is actually should be looked at by people who are trying to help people as a symptom and not a disorder. But you have to write gender dysphoria down to get them on hormones and get them surgery. That's the key words, the knock on the door, you know, to get in, you have to say gender dysphoria. Now, some of that might be fading away with Planned Parenthood. I don't know that they don't care what you say, but so the terminology I like to use is just getting your life back. And I don't like it when people say I detransitioned. I just got my life back. God mm-hmm. gave me my life back.
Now, do you like the term, just to go back to the previous thing you were talking about, do you think gender identity disorder is an okay term to use?
I do.
Okay, and tell us why. What does that mean in your mind?
I think that describes better what was really going on. And here's the thing. When you pop the word disorder in there, then it requires us as helping person to look for what that disorder is. Because mm-hmm. identity disorder is that you have to find out what caused that disorder.
Well, and it's a tacit acknowledgement that there is an order.
Yes.
That there's something rightly ordered. And yes. within our society, we've gotten to the point where the whole, do you know the word queer is used as a verb sometimes? So to queer something means to overturn the standard of normality, whatever the normal standard is, whatever that we're going to challenge and overturn and transgress it, whatever, you know, they're against anything that's normal. Okay.
Right.
So as soon as you say disorder, that suggests that there is something rightly ordered. And that already is a major statement, you know, to say that we live in an ordered universe and it's our job to align ourselves with what's ordered. Right. And if things are disordered, then we need to figure out what's the right order and try to get ourselves back in shape. So is that consistent with your thought process about why gender identity disorder is different in kind from gender dysphoria?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And I think also, you know, the word detransition, the word itself suggests to the listener of that word is that I actually transitioned, that somebody actually. And so that bothers me. It's like mm-hmm. that's to me, that's giving power to the gender clinic that they were successful at transitioning you. And so by stopping using that word, we can take away that power that they actually were successful. I don't like the idea that we're using a word that makes them sound like they did their job, they transitioned you, and now you're finding a way to detrans. No, they didn't. And so you're getting your life back. How did you get your life back is because you realize that something in this process, in my terms, you know, I sat down and did the fourth step. For everybody, it's different. Some people, I've had people write me and just say, I got tired of doing this. That was, they just flat out said, I got tired. There was no magical bullet. I just got tired of playing this game. And I think that's legit.
And I just want to say that getting the terminology correct is not mere semantics, okay? A lot of the sexual revolution has proceeded by means of language, linguistic games, linguistic subterfuge of one sort or another. And so the last thing you want to do is to carry water for your opponents. Exactly. And if you use their terminology, you're doing half of their job for them. So
thank you for that, because you nailed where I'm at. That's exactly where I'm at. I don't want to carry their water.
Yeah. And you and I having this conversation, I feel like we're both clarifying this and making it stronger in our minds, because now it's just occurring to me, the difference between gender dysphoria and gender identity disorder. Gender dysphoria is the claim that you are uncomfortable with your body. It's all about your feelings.
Right.
And that if you feel uncomfortable, that's a problem. We're going to deal with your feelings. It has nothing to do with whether we deal with reality or not. We're never even concerned with reality.
Exactly.
That's a problem. That's a problem.
Huge problem. That's right. That's why we're in the state that we're in. That is the problem. There is no reality.
You know, years ago, I remember somebody telling me, and I don't know what the occasion for this was, but somebody said, you can change your name legally for any reason you want. Anybody can change their name. You can change your name to Daffy Duck if you want to change your name to Daffy Duck, as long as you are not changing your name in order to deceive someone.
Right.
If you're changing your name in order to commit fraud against someone, then that's going to be a problem. But you can change your name to Donald Duck if you feel like it. And so I'm thinking to myself, okay, I can change my name to Donald Duck, but that doesn't make me a duck.
No.
And you changed your name to Laura. That didn't make you a woman.
No. Yeah. And I think here's another thing that's bothered me for a long time is that what an insult it is to women for a man to take hormones and have surgery and say they're a woman. There is no equality here. This is like so ridiculous that a man it is, and I've had this conversation say, is a woman just nothing more than a man with his genitals removed and hormones in him? Process that. And this is the insanity. I mean, there's so much. I mean, wow. I mean, women are special, unique, wonderful human beings. And for this whole gender identity baloney to take away that wonderful thing that women really are. Unique, powerful, special, who bring actually are what makes people come into this world. They have the system,
right?
Nobody would be here without a woman. And a guy who cuts his genitals off is never going to be that woman.
Right. And you know, this would take us too far afield to talk about this, but I just want to mention at this point that there's a whole branch now of theology called the theology of the body. And you may have heard of it and know that it was originated by Pope St. John Paul II in his years of pastoral counseling, realizing that young married couples were struggling with a lot of things, you know. But the core question that John Paul asks in that body of work is, what is God trying to say to us when he made us male and female? God is revealing something. What is it? You know, that's what we need to find out about. Yeah. That's what we need to plug into. What is God trying to say to us? So, Walt, I want to, you know, we've been talking for quite a little while here. There's one question I want to make sure that we spell out for people, because we've gone around it, but I want to ask you just flat out, what can people do to be helpful to people who are on this journey? If you've got loved ones, family members, friends, anybody who's on this journey, what can people do to be helpful? What are some of the things people should refrain from doing?
Yeah. And again, this is just obviously just my opinion, and probably people listening that won't agree. And then that's all right. When a parent says, I have a trans kid, I say, no, you don't have a trans kid. You have a confused child. And why is he confused? And so I think it's important for us. And I love I've never used that term carry their water, but that's exactly what we need to get away from. We are doing that too much on the side of us who are believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, who understand that there's only man and woman, and that there's a lot of people who are confused because of either there's something that happened. So I think it's important for people to push back in a loving way and just say, you know, you're not a trans. You can identify as a transgender, but you can't ever become one. And and find unique ways of challenging their thinking, like I've done with men who's, and I say, why do you want to become like your mom? And they go, what? Yeah, I mean, that's kind of startling to some of them. They never even thought about that. I'm not abusive to people, but I want them to think. I don't buy anything anybody tells me. And I think we need to be better at when somebody says I'm this or I'm that, and they throw in a label on themselves. Why do you want to have that label? Where'd that come from? How did that start? And so stop with the labels. And I think there's another thing with this whole label thing is so popular on TikTok that if you're now a detransitioner, that is one of the most amazing things. We have people writing books. We have people doing documentaries. And I'm going, no. I mean, they're doing it because it's a popular thing to do, but it's not accurate language.
Yeah, yeah. So your point number one, if you've got a loved one in your life, is be sure you use accurate language, that you resist putting a label on them as if that is their final identity and their final destiny in life.
You're a beautiful girl, or you're a handsome boy, and I've actually had put those words into parents' mouths. Sit down with your daughter and say, you're a beautiful daughter. Why don't you? I mean, I look at you and I see you're beautiful. You're a handsome boy. You're a smart boy. Use that terminology instead of this other. If we spent as much time affirming our boys and girls the way they really are, how many of them would be going to the gender clinic? So we got to stop the nonsense. I mean, we're using like, I need to tell them that you need to use it. No, you don't need to use a pronoun.
And the fact that the gender ideology insists on using the pronoun, they think it's important. Therefore, we need to think it's important also. It's important for us to resist it. If it's that important to them, then we got it. Then we can't go along with it. You know, I think that's really wise.
Yeah.
Well, what other projects do you have coming up?
Yeah,
we're doing this interview. We're talking to each other in the fall of 2024. You've always got something cooking. Tell people what new things you have coming up.
Well, as you know, I'm a senior fellow with Family Research Council, and I'm working with Jennifer Bowens, who is a PhD trauma therapist, and also has been a professor at Princeton and New York University. And she contacted me a year ago, and we are writing a book. We have just finished the last edits on it, and it's called Embracing God's Design of Man and Woman. And so that book will be out probably in October or November. And we've taken the expertise of a trauma therapist, a professional, a longtime researcher. She's an excellent researcher. Jennifer Bowen's a beautiful, bright lady. With the guy off the street who lived the life. And we've put the two together and made this amazing book called Embracing God's Design. And then my wife and I are putting together a book that should be out later, maybe in December, maybe early in next year, called After Gender is Jesus.
Oh.
And then I have a movie that I've been working on since 2021, called Who Am I? And that's in the works, but those are long, long projects. A lot of work going into that. Spent a lot of time script writing, and we're in the script writing process. And so that's a huge fundraiser, you know, where you need a lot of money. And so
crowdsourcing. Yeah.
Yeah.
Can people fund that? Can you give us the website where people could go if they wanted to learn about it?
Yeah, it's called themoviewhoami.com. Themoviewhoami.com. You can make a $5, $20, up to $200. We don't want people making big donations on there. We want a lot of people making small donations to get some money in, because you never know where it's going to go. And it's hard to get movies out. And so, yeah, themoviewhoami.com. A little support would be wonderful.
Okay. Well, Walt, do you have any closing comments that you'd like to make to the Ruth Institute followers? It's been just a joy talking with you. Every time I talk to you, I learn so much. But do you have any closing comments you'd like to make to the Ruthies?
Yeah, to the Ruthies and everybody listening, I think it's important for us to know that you are doing an outstanding job and gaining quite an audience. I'm in the sunset of my years, and I'm fading out probably, you know, sometime next year. I don't know. As I get I'm putting a lot of things together. And so I want people to continue to support you, but realize that the most important thing is there are no transgenders. Nobody ever transitioned, and they probably don't have gender dysphoria. Our job is to find out what it really is and start thinking that way and stop carrying their water and using their terminology and think about the fact that the real terminology we need to be using must honor and glorify God.
Walt Heyer, thank you so much for being my guest today. It has been an absolute joy talking with you, and I know that many people are going to be blessed by this conversation. Thank you so much.
My pleasure. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.